Wentworth Town Council, November 7, 2019, meeting will now come to order. If you would, please bow your head for the invocation, please. Dear Lord, please be with us here tonight as we do business of the town. Please be with those that protect us both here and overseas, and be with the needy and everyone that needs your help. Bless everyone, Lord. For it's in your name, I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Next item on the agenda is approval of the town council agenda. We have a couple of speakers here. I'm making a motion that we add Baltazar and Bonnie Cruz to Article 7, the town administrator's updates.
I'll second.
Have a motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Motion carries. And then we have, is that Angel Golston?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I move that we, for the home of refuge, and I make a motion that we hear her under public comments under Article 8.
I second.
Have a motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Okay, now, I'd like to make a motion that we approve the agenda as amended.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Next item on the agenda is approval of the minutes. Anybody has a copy?
I'd like to make a motion that the minutes stand approved as written.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? Not all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
You mean y'all can't hear me?
Loud
as I am?
Might not be on the recorder.
Okay. We don't have any old business. I'm going to move on to new business. Under A, we have consideration of approval for longevity pay for our two employees who are so dedicated to their jobs. I make a motion that we approve the longevity pay for George and Yvonne.
I second.
Have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? Not all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. For the main part of the show, we have the town administrator's updates.
Y'all are keeping me busy these days. If you take a look at your administrator notes there with page one with 204 County Home Road, Ritterbug did come back in today. They came out to install the dehumidifier and to clean the floor joists. And when we went into the basement, there was evidence of powder post beetles had returned. And as you will recall, they were the contractor that when the renovation was taking place, that did the pest control service there when we needed it. And they contacted the town after that, and I shared that with you about if we wanted to do an extended warranty contract with them since the work was new. And you said yes, it's a good thing you did. They came back a couple, 3 years ago and had to retreat for termites evidence again. And then when they found the powder post beetles, they checked and found out that was in force, and so they needed to come back and treat that. They came today, and after having done the cleaning and the installation and stuff, and there was a little bit of an issue with the dehumidifier, but they corrected that. I have not had an opportunity to go down and inspect the work. I'll try to get down there tomorrow, but we think that that's now been taken care of. So that's good. Building security.
Let me ask you, the powder post beetles going to be a recurring problem?
The treatment should have eliminated them. And that, I would say the first time, I don't know. I mean, I didn't, when we went in initially to look at it for their inspection, when they were doing the termite inspection and everything, there was no evidence of the powder post beetles there. But when we went, and this was a, was it about 6 or 8 weeks difference between the two when they came in to do the dehumidifier and to clean, there was sawdust on the floor matching the beams up above where they were. And of course, they said that they were there. So I don't know the answer to that. My understanding is they treated it should be gone, but that's what I would have expected 4 or 5 years ago when it was originally done.
Right.
And that's why keeping the contract, I think, is, and getting the annual inspections is a good thing to do.
Right.
It was disconcerting. I don't deny that.
Just have to keep an eye on it.
Absolutely.
You may have to use something stronger on it.
Yeah. All right, with the Wentworth Consolidated School site, the specifically building security, doors, locks, and hardware, that's probably what's going to take us most of our discussion time with that. But pages 1 and 2 there, you have some notes. If you will turn to pages 3, 4, and 5 of the administrator notes, and particularly 4 and 5, which has the floor plans, when we had the door closer at the post office malfunctioned, and I needed a quick fix on that before we could get a replacement for it, I contacted Balta Cruz, and he came out there that day and switched it out and took care of it for us. When we had the issue with the folks that broke into the school and broke the 3 windows that were there, et cetera, and we needed to get those covered, I contacted Balta, and within 48 hours he was there and had put plywood over those and done that so it was secured. So the handling, when we started talking about doing the doors, hardware, and locks, the locksmith said the project was way too broad for him to be able to handle, that it would be a good idea for me to get a contractor to look at the doors and the hardware and to look at making repairs to those first, and then we could address locks later. So I contacted Balta and from Cruz Carpentry, and Bonnie and Balta, I'll get y'all to come up to the podium, if you will. And they've been, I gave them keys to the place and let them come in and have looked the place over. And I'm going to let them talk to you about some of the complexities of this and maybe with some suggestions of what to do.
Hey, how y'all doing?
Good. Thank you for having us. So originally, George reached out to us to take a look at making some repairs and prepping the mostly exterior doors for the locksmith to come in and to be able to secure them properly with the appropriate hardware. When we went out and took a look at the doors, we have the list that you have in your packet of doors numbers 1 through 41. There are numbers skipped because they weren't relevant to this project. But we went out and we examined each door that we could look at front and back. Some of them we could only get to one side. And we took photographs, and we have those available tonight.
Yvonne, could I have the screens for a moment, please?
So our goal originally was to come up with a plan to make repairs to each door, noting the individual repairs and reporting that back to George with some type of, reasonable price range for what it would take. Sometimes when you're dealing with repairs, you may find damage that you didn't see on the surface, so there's always just a little bit of margin there that you have to work with. When we walked the property, what we saw was most of the doors are not eligible for repairs in the sense that it would be a lot of money and you would still have a repaired door that wouldn't be long-term satisfactory. So we talked with George about that and said, how can we proceed, or are we just going to not do this? How can we do this? And of course, there's some issues of fire safety with locks and things like that. So this project has to happen. So we took another step back and we consulted with the local vendor, Alex Rothrock at Reasonable Builder Supply, to take a look at the photos and look at an original. We have, I believe this is from way back in the day.
I had also talked with him, y'all told me last time to also look at windows, and I had provided Alex with a copy, 2 pages of the blueprints, and it had information about the doors on those pages of the blueprints as well, so he had access to that information.
Which was great, because that told us that even though it's obvious through the years, several of the doors have been modified, that there is a consistency with the original openings. So that's a good way to look at approaching a replacement of doors that need to be replaced. Now, we are not able to give you a solid bottom line figure on what it would cost you for the materials, because there's decisions that have to be made, and those decisions, I believe, are in your hands. With regard to if you have an existing wood door, would you like it to be wood again? Would you like for it to be steel? If there's a window, do you want to keep the window in the door? Would you rather it be a solid slab? And then what is the nature of the hardware that you need on it? Does it need a crash bar, or does it simply need a manual operating handle? So these are decisions that need to be made on a case-by-case basis. So we were looking at, instead of doing one big project, which could get tedious for the decision makers, to really look at the doors from the perspective of smaller projects. Which ones are most urgent, based on whatever criteria you have, maybe fire safety first. Then which ones are not structurally sound, but they still operate. Again, there's a lot of variables here. I would summarize those variables. Also, keep in mind that different doors made by different manufacturers, they're made differently. So what happens is one manufacturer's hinge pattern will be different than another. So that's where someone like Mr. Rothrock, who understands the hinge placement, he can identify who the manufacturer was for a door. You know, we can get him to look at these and say, this manufacturer made this door, we can replace just that slab. Here you're going to need a whole, well, we can identify when you need a whole new frame, an entire door kit, versus just replacing one slab of a door. So I'm talking a lot, I don't want to get too bogged down. That's basically what we're looking at, the decision-making process. We do have the photos, we'll be glad to go through those with you to help you understand the kind of things that we see that we would need guidance on to give you more information.
And as they've developed that information, and as far as prioritization that I see, security obviously is number one on that list. Number two is making the fire marshal happy by not creating something that's going to lock people in should they break in it, be in it, and it catches on fire. We want them to be able to get out. To me, what seems logical is to address the ones where we have padlocks on those and chains, and get those to where they can be secured, and we can get rid of the chains and padlocks so that it's that much is taken care of initially. But eventually, I'm going to go through some of the photos that you have here and just kind of address some stuff as I go along.
And also, George, as you go along, I have on some of the photos, I have some notes here that I'll let you know that I have a particular note about that.
Okay. So if you look at the floor plan, 1 through 6, obviously, that's the entryway into the gym. At present, the only door that's keyed is number 4. And that gives you access into the gym there without a whole lot of problem. This is the interior of door number 1, exterior door number 1, interior door number 2, and exterior of 2. Notice there's a padlock with a hasp on it, which is not good if you're having people using the gym. 3, 4, which you can see that's the keyed entry. five, and six. And I know that just generally talking, we can probably for the time being get by with this as is, but at some point in time, we're going to need to address it. And another, I think on these, using keeping glass in the doors is a good idea, because whoever's in the building, if they're coming out and there's somebody trying to come in, they've got to be able to see them. So that's something to think
also,
about.
Also,
on exterior doors?
Yes.
With the glass?
Yes.
Them?
Well, you don't, okay, what are it, 17 steps up to the landing that's there? You don't want somebody coming up the steps, getting to the door, and somebody going boom.
How big is that glass?
I'm not sure. But it's the kind of thing, go ahead.
So when you use a steel door, if you and we can use wood also, but presumably at this entrance you might replace with steel, you can have a window pane, and it can be double paned with insulation so that it's some, you know, offering some weatherproofing there. And the security, as far as the resilience against breakage, you know, that's a factor that can be looked at too.
Well, even if they break one of these window panes, they'd still have to have a key to access it if it, we had it set up, right?
I mean, with this door, no, because what they could do is break the glass, reach in and grab the crash bar and pop it.
So it's got a crash bar on the inside?
It's on the inside, yes. And the crash bar is necessary for, you know, quick egress, for a quick exit, just like what we have here at Town Hall.
Well, maybe where you've got a crash bar on the inside, you need to use some kind of heavy-duty plexiglass. It's harder to break than glass.
Right.
I don't want them to be able to break
right.
the glass and reach in and open the door with the crash bar.
Right. Well, and one of the doors that Balta did the repair with the plywood over, we had that door chained. Had it not been chained when they broke the glass to that door to the cafeteria, then they could have popped the crash bar and then been into the building. It kept them from getting in that way. Of course, then they went through the back door, which was the most least secure in place. All right, seven, this is the basement of the gym. I don't think that we have to rush into, but at some point in time, but this is on the front. And you can see what a horrible shape that's in.
What you have here is what appears to have been a wooden frame door with a wood door slab in it that at some point was replaced with what appears to be a metal door. It does need to be replaced. It is closed for security reasons. You are the gap at the bottom is pretty significant. So for weatherproofing and things like that, this is not great. And for vermin,
yeah,
that's another thing we're looking at. You know,
and they know how much I like vermin. So.
You know, so
that's an exterior.
Yeah.
Yes.
Water,
you see it number seven here. Okay. Eight. This is the one that leads into the from the north side there. You see it on the floor plan. It's still number eight.
We really wanted this door to be fixable because, and keep in mind,
talking about eight.
Yeah, every door that we see in this door plan is not a lost cause. There are some that can be worked with. We just have to see what your intention is, and then in some cases where they were locked on both sides, we have to be able to access it and really evaluate it and work with it. So we wanted this door to be fixable. The rust is really pitted. We talked about, can we deal with the rust? But it's pretty significant. And on the next slide after that is the inside shot. I'm sorry, the lighting wasn't so great. That is the basement of the gym. It was the best I could get. You will see a big gap there. And also to address, going back to briefly to the gym doors 1 through 6, in this slide here, there is a window, a light. So that could be an option if you're concerned about having big windows on the front of the gym doors. You could always go with something smaller so you people could see each other, but then, you know, it just feels like you're not having that big of a...
Yeah, the window space here, you see how small it is on this compared to...
So these are options that we would need some guidance on. The slide after that, it continues with number 8, and you'll see that there is a piece of metal, a piece of steel has been placed there as some type of temporary measure to make it hold together. And that crash bar doesn't work either. Like I said, we really wanted to say we can work with this. However, because this opening, again, if it's especially if it's a steel frame, we may only be looking at slabs, and that's a lot more affordable than having to replace the entire kit.
So we got how many doors total? Looks like we're skipping some numbers.
Oh, let's see. I put that in the notes.
That's it, 26.
26.
26.
But if we want to prioritize, again, I would go after the ones that can't be secured without a chain, and we could focus on those first if you wanted.
Well, what about the not-a-key doors at the gym, as far as getting back into the gym?
Number 4 is your door that has the key, has like a deadbolt. And that's where if you were to try to enter through that side of the building, you would go through number 4 with your key. And then the other 5 doors...
They're locked.
Well, they have the crash bar on the inside. So it's designed for people to come out.
They've got glass in them, don't they?
Yes.
That's your wooden, yes. Yeah. Okay.
Well, if we got 26, let's just bust them up into groups of 5 or 6 and let's do 6 to keep from having to deal with so many of them at one time and think about it and say we're going to do this to that one, this to that one. Let's pick a group, you know, if it's 5, it's 6, whatever, 7 in an area. And
may I make a suggestion?
Mr. Cruz, give us a price on what they think they're going to run into there.
Then I would make a suggestion this and go after the ones with chains. I would look at 12, 15, 37, 40, and 17.
Okay, and just make that our first group. And
because those are the well, and we also 18 and 19 have chains on them. But if we're looking for a starting point, those would be the ones to go to. We can look at 18, 19, 29, and 30 at a later time.
Oh, you're going to do that at a later time. All right, give me the numbers again.
I would suggest we do 12. 15.
I don't have a 15.
15 is next to 12. It's the one leading on the slick hall.
It's not on the lead.
It's not on our list.
It's not. No. My apologies. Then
15. Okay. Yeah. I wrote it in.
With that.
Slick hall. Okay.
17. 17 is the one that was where we had when we had the. There it is. That's the one that somebody was able to pull open and that I most lately added a chain to.
Okay. All right. What else?
37.
Oh, 15, 7. 37.
And 40.
And 40. And let's look at that group, figure out what you need, what has to be done. You know, if there's an option there that's can save us any money, whether it's steel or wood, you know, we'll look at that and then give you a go-ahead on it and let y'all get started on it. And then let's just do them in groups. We'll just keep this list right here and try to do 5 or 6 or 7 a month, and we'll knock it out in 4 or 5 months.
Okay.
And be done with them. and we'll start with those.
And we like that idea too. We feel like that we can, you know, we can approach it from that perspective. Certainly the vendor can too.
All right. Well, let's look at those, and if y'all would, just get the materials, labor, what you think it's gonna cost to get it done. And if we run into anything, you know, that's, I had an old house redone. They were shaving the four befores in my doors to get them square. So you may run into something. Just let us know and we'll look at that. But start with that group of doors right there and go ahead and get the stuff together on it and give it back to George. Do we have anything dedicated for that down there at this point in time?
No, we'd
have to approve it.
We'll need to do a budget amendment to add some to property improvements for all that work.
Okay, let's see how much they come up with this first group of doors, and then we'll kind of go from there and do the amendments as we run along. And that way we can spread it out. We don't have to do it all in 1 month, but at the same time, we'll make pretty decent time on if we do 5 or 6 of them a month. Can you do that, man?
Yeah.
I don't want to overload you there. You run into a hard one, yeah, you can spend some time on it. Okay. All right. Well, that sounds good. We'll just work off this list here. Everybody hold on to that. And we'll go look at them each month. And once y'all bring that back to us, we'll go ahead and approve it. Do a budget amendment for it.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
All right. Thank y'all.
Appreciate you coming out. Thanks for that.
Thank y'all.
And on page 6 of the administrator notes, the roof repair, I made the notation that when we finally did have some rain, I went down and inspected, and there was one spot in the northeast corner stairwell, and it still was leaking. And additionally, there was one of the windows.
Northeast corner stairwell.
Yep, that's on the back side of the gym, on the side, ball field side, that corner, where the stairwell is there.
Oh, going down into the gym basement?
Yes.
Okay.
And I also, when it was, I went over there while it was raining, and there was water coming off of the roof, cascading onto one of the windows behind where that crossover is from the main to the crow's nest, and water was coming in through around that window frame, but water was running down the window. So when I contacted David McCollum, and he came back out, he and his crew came back out, they found what the problem was on the back corner and have corrected it. I'm still going to go down there in rain and check it and make sure that it's fine. And the problem with the where the water was coming across the window and working in was because the drain was clogged up there, and they cleaned it out. And that I'll check it when it rains and make sure that that's no longer a problem as well.
Okay.
But it should be. They got in there fairly quickly and took care of that. So hopefully, I'll wait when I have good rain and go down there and check.
Okay.
Windows. You authorized me at the last meeting to check into what some possibilities were with windows, and I'm not expecting you to make a decision tonight, but I wanted to give you this information I got this week. I mean, I think Tuesday, Wednesday morning, really. So I wanted to share this with you, and so that you have something you can take a look at and read at your leisure. And Yvonne, I gave you a copy. Do you want one of these too? Okay. And I'm going to give you this too. This is a copy off of the original blueprints for the school. And this is part of what I provided Alex Rothrock at Reedsville Building to look at. And what he did is he went to a window company engineer who took a look at it, and his the discussion that they had was that rather than trying to have something designed to fit the space, that what would be better would be to use replacement windows that could be retrofitted into place. And there were some advantages with that, one of them being that you could use an energy efficient glass, and in that particular type of a setup, you would get breakage, the breakage would be covered, a covered thing. So if a window got broken, you'd get replaced.
That sounds good, man.
So there were, if you look at the packet that I've just given you here, and I'll read what I put in the email to them. I will share the information you have provided with Town Council at Thursday's regular meeting for November. While this item is included in my administrator's notes, that is part of their agenda packets for the November 7th meeting. The specifics of your work submitted here have yet to be formally presented and discussed. I expect that the mayor and town council will want to take some time before deciding what action to take with the information you have provided for consideration. That said, your work has provided some detailed and achievable solutions that address window replacement at the Wentworth Consolidated School Gym. I genuinely appreciate the work you have provided regarding this project and will keep you apprised of how things progress. And if you look at the quote that he has here on page 2 of 2, keep in mind that that is for windows and materials only. It does not include labor. I was surprised at that. Favorably surprised at that. Cost.
And what all that include?
What he has listed here in the quote. Yeah. And I also included, I think I had shown this to you before, but this is part of the, with the photographs of the different windows where I had numbered them for identification purposes to try to get an idea of the project and what we would need to do. Right. And you've seen this before, but like on the second page where you have the north side, where I highlighted those in yellow, those are the ones right now that have the plexiglass screwed over them. And you know, that's, I just so that you can reference what's in the packet. I guess my suggestion right now, this is too much information for us to make any kind of decision this evening, I believe, but I think you need it to look at it, but that's something that looks rather doable. And again, when I talked with Alex about this, I said it may be the kind of thing where we need to do this window and then check another window at another time and another window at another time. We could prioritize, if we want to go with this plan, we could prioritize, say, the ones where panes are broken and missing, and prioritize to get those done first. And then, you know, we would have to hire a contractor to do the installation. And again, Cruise Carpentry would be a possibility, or we could put it out for bids, whatever you think's best on that. All kinds of things to think about with it. But I'd like for you to have this and look at it so that you have an opportunity to kind of think it through and can maybe give us some direction in the not too distant future on this.
Well, if you bounce around too much, I mean, you end up going back and having to set up stuff to go in and fix another window that you left a week ago or something like that. You might as well, if you're up there working, go ahead and get whatever's in that general area. They'll cut back on labor setting up and all.
Right.
Anyway, we need to look at this a little bit.
Well, and I appreciate council authorizing me to look into this, and I'm pleased with the result at this time,
yeah,
too, because that begins to look like it's something that's doable.
Because I'd like to get that fixed and get those doors fixed and get the gym up and back up where we can use it.
thinking about that, I was just sitting here thinking, all right, if we do the windows, we prepared the roof, some work's going to have to be done on the floor. I'm almost 100% sure that bleachers probably don't meet code anymore. Now that it's been transferred, we probably can't use them.
I don't know. It might be the type of thing where you need somebody, an engineer, to come in and look at it. The thing that concerns me about the bleachers is there's a lot of rust because water had made it into different areas.
Looked like an estimated oil.
Yeah, and it could be that it could be cleaned and oiled and they could be okay.
Okay.
I mean, you're at Homes now, mm-hmm. but at Western, did you ever go underneath those? I mean, some of those were in pretty foul shape there too. I don't think they were as bad as some of the stuff that I've seen here because you didn't have the amount of water that had gotten in. But it could be something where you sandblast it or something and get rid of the rust, lubricate it and get it back into shape. And it may, but that's where you need to get somebody that's got expertise
right.
in that area. And
then we've also, looking at bleachers, and then, you know, depending on the time of year you're going to use it, HVAC, heating, cooling, that sort of stuff. And those are all things that we're going to have to do to get the gym, I think, up to use. So I think those are
well, and then
they have those heaters up there.
They still work.
Don't know if they do or they don't. And I don't know if they're electric or gas. I'm not sure which one that.
Seems like I remember them working at some point not too awful long ago.
Well, and the other thing is restrooms. We pay for sewer and we pay for water for that facility. My understanding is with those restrooms, if we took out the fixtures and sanded everything down and painted it and put in new fixtures, we don't have to get a permit for that. That's just a remodel, is my understanding. I'll confirm that. So again, we would not have to again worry about ADA standards at this point in time. At some point in time, we may want to worry about ADA standards.
Right.
But I'm trying to think of things that we can do. You know, I checked with Carrie when she was at the last meeting about the windows and doors, and that's not an issue. We can do some things, maybe even get the restrooms where they're up in good shape.
Yeah.
There's a lot of cleaning that needs doing. There's a lot of trash and stuff in there, but that's throughout the entire building that needs cleaning out.
Well, they were renting that first floor down there, and
those window heaters. The heaters that they had on the first floor were fine.
Yeah.
That was something that they installed. But I think the gym.
Well, that's air conditioning, too.
Yeah, like I think the gym is separate. It's probably
it
those old heaters that are original. I don't even
know. Oh, yeah, it's separate. I mean, but I was just saying that the first floor down there, you could actually rent it if you got the bathroom in good shape down there.
Are you talking about the bathrooms on those halls?
No, I'm talking about the restrooms in the gym itself.
Okay. In the gym itself?
Yes. I would, you know, that you're talking about things. When I've talked with you with council before, it seemed that your priority was let's get the gym and the ball field into shape and let's see if we can get it up to where it's for recreational use.
We have a working bathroom on the first floor.
Yes.
Yeah.
On the ground floor.
Right.
Yes.
On the ground floor.
Yes.
Yeah.
But I'm talking about for the gym itself,
right. Yeah.
and
that's fine.
Redoing those. Again, there's a lot of small projects, but there's expense involved with each of those, and you know, so.
Yeah.
Well, if you just take small chunks at a time and just keep going and eventually get it all done at some point in time. Hopefully we will live that long.
Yeah. Security cameras, the mayor had asked me to look into that. The sheriff's office no longer had any that were working that we could use, and I have asked, Deputy Burns had talked with me about possibly using something that, oh, let me give you back. I'm sorry, I took away your screen. I'm sorry, I'll close that out.
That's okay. I don't need it right now.
Well, I'm done. but had talked about maybe using a type of camera that has connected to a cell service.
Right.
That could send out an alert and also record if somebody were back there. He and I talked about it, and I decided that the best thing to do was to talk with our IT. So I've talked with Rick Wall. Rick's looking into it, and he hasn't, we don't have anything definitive there to look at present time with that. Rick kind of leans toward having wired cameras rather than something that's dependent on cell service, if we want to put cameras down there.
You gonna set up all night long and watch?
No, the thing that, what Ryan had talked about was that if the, with the cell, the ones that have cell service, you can set it up that if it's, there's motion, like the groundhog comes out or whatever, anyway, that it would call, actually call an assigned number, and he said he could use his department office phone, you know, there as the contact for that.
But that'd pick up any kind of motion.
We were talking about putting one on the house, maybe one or two on the outside, also one on the inside, so if it picked up motion, it would send a signal to download the app to your phone and give you an alert. The only bad thing is there's reoccurring cost to it, because you need to put SIM cards in each camera and have data attached to that for it to send a signal.
So you not only have the sunk cost of the camera, but then the service to...
So it works just like a trail cam, it sends that to...
That's what me and George were looking at with the trail cams.
Right.
What the lieutenant detective's pointing one out to me that they're looking at getting. And you just put a Verizon SIM card in it, and it sends an alert out every time, that way you don't have to go back and check.
Yeah, I've seen that.
And then I think if it gets, it might actually do a locate on it too, if it gets stolen. So... Just something to look into.
Okay.
But they're
kind of
expensive.
Yeah, yeah, but I mean, a lot of people use them though. I don't know people that's got them. Okay.
But Rick's still looking into that, and we'll hopefully have a little bit better idea soon with that. Also, with developing comprehensive plan, I did submit the application, and on page 8 of the administrator notes, I have there the response. Quote, thank you for submitting a project for consideration by graduate students enrolled in the community revitalization course at UNC Chapel Hill. Students make project selections at the beginning of each semester, January in the spring, August in the fall. We will contact you if your proposal is selected or if we need more information about the project. So that has been submitted, and hopefully we'll get some response.
Okay.
Two things that I did not have in my notes and I wanted to share with you, because one of these came up at the last meeting. There was question about with the park and the ball field, or excuse me, not ball field, with the park and the playground. And I contacted Jeff, and he got back with me and shared this quote here. The playground is in the base bid, but it is an allowance of $100,000, which means it can be removed if the total bids are higher than the town is prepared to pay or left in the contract. Either way, we will then meet the playground equipment contractor to determine what play equipment to include. It is done this way because the different playground companies all have different equipment, and that makes it difficult to bid apples to apples. Playgrounds and their safety surfaces are expensive, and this leaves you a way to do it or not do it based on the final bid price. So I know that that was a source of concern last time, and I apologize for not having a clear understanding of that, but I did want to share that with you. The other item I wanted to share with you is this notice. This was published in the Greensboro News and Record beginning Wednesday, November the 6th. And I think you have this. And my understanding is that it also should be posted in the Rockingham Now and forthcoming. And we also have it on the website. Specifically, sealed proposals will be received until 2 p.m. on December the 12th, 2019. An open pre-bid meeting will be held at 10 a.m. on November the 21st. And so we're in the process now of looking for bids. The advertisement's been sent out for the construction of the park.
Okay. the deal. They'll probably go to spring before they start at one, so.
I think, Yvonne, you can help me out with this.
Depends on weather.
I think what Jeff said is that he's thinking that by the January meeting.
Saying that at the January meeting, we could have our public hearing that we have to have to say that we're going to borrow money from the bank to pay for a portion of it. And then we could get on the local government commission's mid-January meeting for them to approve it. And so then it would be February when he would start the next process, the next step, which I'm not sure what that would be.
And didn't he say it was like 60 days after that or something? I think that's what I remember that stuck in my mind, but I can't.
Okay.
But anyway, yeah, it sounds like it could be reserved as early spring.
Okay, good deal.
And believe it or not, that's all I have.
Crickets. Okay. Thank you, George. Appreciate that. Ms. Balsar, yeah.
Some good information.
Public comments. We have Angel Golston. Hey, would you like to come up?
I want to thank everyone for allowing me to speak here at the Wentworth Town Council. And the reason I'm here, the Home of Refuge would like to be considered for the Wentworth Consolidated School. I don't know if you know, but there always is around like 300 to 600 homeless people that comes during the wintertime. And I know that the school, I've looked at it, it's a lot of broken windows. I've seen homeless people sleeping around there. But what I haven't seen in reading the minutes of the town council or the township is any discussion of what we're gonna do about the homeless population. And I think it's time that we consider that. I worked here at Daymark for 9 years. I was a homeowner in Stokesdale for a little while until my husband got sick and I had to move to Greensboro. But I'm coming back. And I just feel like that, you know, Home of Refuge should be recognized for a homeless shelter. And there's one desperately needed here. And I just like for us to be considered for that school.
Well, we have a lot of plans for the school. I couldn't say at this point in time that's something that we would do, because of course when we started off, we were going to rent the bottom floor, get the gym and stuff ready, and the ball field, and there's a little building down there was going to be our first part, to where people could get up there and start using the recreational facilities.
Yes, sir.
And that's our first hurdle there. And then we'll look at what we're going to do with the rest of the school. It's going to take us years to get it to the point, where we can get full use of it. And hopefully we may get to use the first floor at some point in time, but there's not a lot of space down there. And we've had folks, approach us already about, renting the first floor down there for first one thing and then the other.
Yes, sir.
But right now, as far as something, that big and using the whole, the school for it, I couldn't say that that's something we'd be able to do. But I heard now at one point in time, they were talking about, wasn't they talking about a shelter down there on Cherokee Camp Road?
Yes.
The commissioners were looking at that.
Yes, sir. And that's still up for consideration, and I do plan to approach them. But I just wanted to make sure that we've heard that we're interested in the Wentworth. And we can show now sustainability, because there is HUD grant money out there. And I've seen HUD tear down buildings and build them, rebuild them. So I've even got people like Bar Construction and a lot of other construction companies that's willing to come out and take a look and rebuild something. You know, and it's all about helping the homeless population.
Well, one of the key issues with this building that, you know, we've alluded to when we talked about ADA compliancy and all that is that, you know, we can do remodeling and there are certain things that we can do, but if we get into renovations and bringing that building, I mean, it's a soon-to-be 100-year-old building up to full ADA compliancy, and we're talking in the millions and millions of dollars. And I believe the initial estimate, the last time a full estimate was done on bringing the building up to just complete ADA compliancy, complete renovated elevators, everything you'd have to do to operate something like that was well over $10 million.
9.8.
Yeah, $9.8 million in 2004. So I'm sure that number's grown. So it's definitely, there's so many possibilities and things that we can do. And, you know, like we've been saying tonight, we're just in that early stage of we own the property, and right now we're just trying to get the property to a point where, you know, issues that windows, leaks, things like that, and then move into that that area of really looking at what we can do with it once we're able to get an idea of what kind of money's going to be available and what we can do and spend to get it, to get the whole building up to code. Because certainly if we were going to, you know, have something like that or office space or senior living, I mean, there are any number of possibilities that we've been approached about. All of that would just involve a complete renovation of the building. So yes. we've got that factor too. But do appreciate the work that you all do.
Well, thank you. And I know it's going to be a lot of work to put that together, but like Mr. Pascal said, I heard him say piece by piece.
Piece by piece.
Piece by piece. And that's what HUD does, piece by piece. And, you know, there's a lot of people that owns companies that's willing to step up from another county to help, you know, and I just think it's time that we'll, you know, try to address this issue. Because I've seen a lot of it working at Daymark as a therapist. And I'm still a therapist, and I still see it, and it needs to be dealt with. So I just want to bring us for consideration.
Thank you. We appreciate that.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. Appreciate everything you do for the community.
You're welcome. Thank you all. Thank you.
And we'll move on to the announcements. If I can read my chicken scratch on the ones we added. The next regular meeting of the Wentworth Planning Board is scheduled for Tuesday, November 19th, 2019 at 7 p.m. in the Town Hall Council Chambers. The next regular meeting of the Wentworth Town Council is scheduled for Tuesday, December 3rd, 2019 at 7 p.m. in the Town Hall Council Chambers. The Town Hall will be closed Monday, November 11th, 2019 in observance of Veterans Day, and the Town Hall will be closed November 28th through 29th, 2019 in observance of the Thanksgiving holiday. Our Christmas parade for the town of Wentworth is Saturday, December 14th at 11 a.m. Parade entry forms are here at the Town Hall, or you can go to our website at www.townofwentworth.com and get them online. Friends of Chinkapin Walking Trail are holding a ribbon cutting for phase one of the Chinkapin Stew Restoration project that they have going, and that will be tomorrow morning at what time was that, Yvonne?
10:30.
Then the Grand Marshal for the Christmas Parade. Can I make a recommendation?
Yeah, I mean, everybody can.
We need to make a decision. I'd like to recommend Mr. Dave Higgins. He was the pastor at First Baptist Church in Reedsville. He has been in the past at Calvary Baptist Church. When somebody's in need of a funeral, or he's always been willing to step in, step up, and do whatever he can.
And he lives over in University Estates, down the street from here.
Mm-hmm.
it would be, I think it would be somebody that would, that would be a good idea. I agree.
Can we take that up with a motion since we didn't have it on the agenda? Or?
You don't have to make a motion about it.
Okay.
You can just direct me to contact him and ask him if he'd be willing to do that.
Is everybody okay with it? Iris? You all right with Mr. Huggins? Duggins? What was his name?
Dave Huggins.
Dave Huggins.
Dave Huggins.
Wait a minute, you got to talk loud on that.
Dave Huggins. Dave Huggins being the grand marshal for the parade.
Oh, yeah.
You okay
with
that?
Is he able?
If he's able, if he wants to.
Oh, yeah, I think that'd be nice.
Yep.
Okay.
Okay.
Go ahead and contact him.
All of a sudden, he just refused to hear.
Okay, unless anybody has any further announcements, I make a motion we adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Meeting stands adjourned. Thank everybody for coming tonight.